Hello there. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Yeah, you. Welcome to Graffiti Royale's Guide to Life, a podcast where the three of us talk about new music releases, what's going on in the industry, life hacks, and we share some dad jokes. Follow our band on all streaming sites and social media, Graffiti Royale. Are you on your way to work? Or are you coming back from work? Are you just home hanging around, huh? Well, regardless, whatever it is, I hope you enjoy this podcast. Now let's go to the episode. Talk soon. Peace.
And we're live.
Yeah, boys.
Cheers, boys.
And we're back. Cheers. Yo.
Cheers.
Hey.
Salute. Hey. And we're back. We're back.
Yes, yes. We are back.
How's the week treating you guys?
Not bad, man. Getting through. It's good. Getting through. Yeah. You?
Pretty good, man. Pretty good. You know? Kicking ass. Kicking ass.
And taking names.
Taking names.
Whose names are you taking?
Dude.
Sounds like Alec and I are the ones taking names.
Right.
We'll send you the list.
Dude, yeah. So, I am the host today, huh? I'm not going to lie, I was been pretty nervous about this process, just hosting. Nervous about it, but let's do it. Let's fucking do it.
I don't know why.
I don't know
why.
Yeah.
Host on many blessed stages.
Dude, fun times. Oh, I remember when I was young.
Actually, I saw a video of someone at SOBs yesterday, and it reminded me of you hosting there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Like an artist?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, shit.
No, well, the video wasn't from an artist. It was from this guy that I used to work with named Max. And he was just like there for a Halloween party.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah, but it was good to see that SOBs is still like, you know, kicking around, doing its thing.
That's
after
sick.
All those years of being there together.
Right. That's sick, dude. Hell yeah. I need to pass by there.
I mean, I feel like it's such an iconic stage.
Oh, hell yeah, dude. It was definitely a staple piece for artists to go through before, a couple years back. Like, artists had to kind of touch that stage, you know?
Yeah.
I wonder what it's like.
Do you think it's still like that?
I don't think so. Yeah. I wonder. Oh, yeah. Hopefully, you know, I can pass by a show soon and see what it is, what it's like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It was fun times, man. That was a lot of fun times back there.
Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, we played there as a band a few times. Mm-hmm. And then Quez and I were host DJ duo for like, what, a year straight?
Dude, yeah.
Something like that.
Oh, my God. That was fun.
Those were fun.
Sean, Trav, you know, shout out to those guys.
Shout out to Trav. I just spoke to Trav the other day, too. Shout out to Trav, man.
Oh, man.
He said, what up, guys?
Well. Man, I miss that guy.
Good old days.
Trav was a real kickstart to Graffiti.
Big time.
I feel like he really like believed in the vision in the beginning and like helped push us along. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
Much love to that guy.
Yeah. Big up. I mean, he kind of put us on SOBs in the beginning, right?
Yeah.
Like, because he was working there and he kind of just brought us in and... Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was awesome to have that support.
Yeah.
So really.
Nah, yeah, 100%. Absolutely. Big up.
Yeah.
So before we get started, I kind of wanted to have like a one little icebreaker question. If money or time wasn't an object, what would you guys be doing right now?
I'd be doing this.
Fire.
Talking to you guys.
Yeah,
maybe in the same room, though.
Maybe in the same room?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that's the goal. Mm-hmm. For me, at least, man, live in the same city as you guys eventually again, record music and the podcast in the same studio, Graffiti Royale studio. I know we all got life obligations and money obligations and time obligations, but if that wasn't a factor, like just more of this.
Just more of this, right? Yeah, same.
I mean, 100%. I hate to steal that answer, but it's the same.
Someone asked me that recently and I was like, oh shit, good question. Yeah, same though, you know, working on music together, living in the same city, playing shows. And just having fun and doing creative shit together. All kind of different creative stuff, you know? I think that would be so fun.
Yeah.
If money and time wasn't an object, that would for sure be it.
I mean, the amazing thing is that, like, we're still making it happen, even with all the other obligations we have. You know, we're, like building the dream while, you know, doing the requirements to just live.
100%. Doing music.
Yeah.
Getting new music out. That would be so sick. While we talk about music, you know, Drake album just came out a couple of weeks ago. I was interested, when I first heard it, I was interested to hear you guys' thoughts.
Alec, you want to go?
I can go first. Yeah, sure. Yeah. I enjoyed most of it. I think it could have been slimmed down a little bit, like after I listened to it more. I think there's some really good songs on there, but it kind of feels like a collection of songs as opposed to like an overall kind of theme or like constructive thread between all of them. So there's some like definitely like really good Drake tracks on this one, but I think it could have been, you know, streamed down a little bit. I think there are like quite a few filler tracks there, but it's just kind of Drake doing what Drake does well. I don't think he like really approached it in a really different way than he's done previously, but I think there's like a good five or six songs on there. Some really good features, like with J. Cole, and that one stands out to me. And I like the Chief Keef song. The Lil Yachty one was pretty cool too. Yeah, I thought it was like a good release, but it sounds like he just needs to take some time off and just kind of, you know, chill out and then, you know, come back and do something really different. I don't know. That's kind of my take after listening to it a bunch. But overall, good.
Yeah, I agree with that too. I feel like he could definitely use some time off. I mean, I know it's like classic Drake to like be like sad and in his feelings, but I just feel like there was a lot of that on this album. Like I just like the overall vibe of this album to me just like felt sad. You know, and like mixed with like cool, like there's some bangers on there and like cool tracks. Like I think what Drake does really well is like get you into his feelings, like whatever he's feeling, you start feeling, you know, like if Drake is like flexing on a track, like I'm driving along listening to that song feeling freaking cool. If Drake is like sad, like, you know, singing a ballad, I'm just like, oh my God, I'm feeling kind of mopey. And he kind of loses me there with some of the, like, I feel like some of the ballady type stuff on this album kind of just, it's kind of like rambly and then like petered out without like a full, like not a lot of like thought behind it other than just like attacking like a melancholy beat with some like sad lyrics about being like done wrong by women and like lonely at the top of the industry, which is like, cool, that's his reality, but I can't really relate to it.
Right.
So, but yeah, I mean, there, and at the same time, there were some like great tracks in there that I thought were really cool. Like, I really liked the Bad Bunny track. I thought that was like kind of a banger. Honestly, I thought the one with his kid was like kind of cool. Kind of like funny. That beat was kind of hard. 8 a.m. in Charlotte was just like a really dope beat. Overall, I'm not mad at this album. Definitely saved a few tracks off of it. So, worth a listen, and also worth just like, you know, at this point, Drake has such a grasp on the industry that he can like kind of do no wrong. And like, I think has a lot of sway in the direction that hip hop is heading. So I think no matter if you like love or hate this album, you, like if you want to be tapped into the music industry, you have to listen to it.
Right. No, he's definitely built himself to that point. Yeah. He's definitely built his career in that way where like, you know, he's such a big artist these days that you kind of got to listen to him to be in tune to what's happening, you know? It's a great point. I thought it was a really good album. There was definitely some standout tracks for me. I feel like this was Drake having fun. I feel like he doesn't have anything to prove anymore. Finally, I feel like he's tapping into that. And this was just like a fun album for him. He was having fun doing the collabs that he'd been wanting to do, talking about the things that he's probably been wanting to talk about, and just having fun in the process. And that's how the album felt to me. It was just like, oh, he's having fun. Just some of those melodies and some of those hooks that he's used and the way he's like saying certain things. It's like, oh, he's definitely, it sounds like he's having fun. It comes across to me that way. Even like the song, What Would Pluto Do? Like things like that. Like, I don't know. It was a very interesting thing to hear from Drake. It was like, oh, this is cool. Definitely too many songs. I feel like I would have cut down at least 5 songs from there. But overall, I think it was a very fun album. It was like, okay.
That's interesting to hear that. Yeah. You interpreted it a little bit differently than I did. Yeah. Like your overall takeaway was fun. My overall takeaway was sad. And like that he has a lot of problems.
Nah, yeah, definitely. No, but... You have such a good point. Like some of those songs are very like kind of sad in a way. Very like energy, like drowning a little bit sometimes, if I'm explaining it correctly. But yeah, no,
draining to listen to.
Yeah, like draining. Or? Yeah, a little draining. But the more I listen to it, the more I'm like, oh, okay, I get it. I get what he's doing, you know. Fear Heights is definitely a standout song to me. So super fucking good. Very braggy. when the beat drops. It's like, instrumentally wise, you know, I think it's amazing. The instrumentals on there is sick. I know you a cat, but can your pussy do the dog? Let's go pound for pound, I'm a yurt. Chrome hard curly, I had it imported. Got in my feelings, I had to record it. I never met a bitch that was a... But yeah, Drake does what Drake does.
Yeah, but the switch-ups were really cool too on a lot of the tracks. Uh-huh. Like, it seemed like not most of them, but like there's a good chunk of tracks that like kind of switch up near the middle, and it just kind of like really adds more life to the songs. Right. Like, Fear of Heights was a great example. Mm-hmm. Daylight, even like Virginia Beach, which I keep mm-hmm. going back to. It was like the first track on the album. It just has such a cool vibe. I think he sampled Frank Ocean for that one. Fantasizing, that's not love. You're in this more like compromising. I move mountains for you for that social climbing. Lean into me. Yeah, it's funny because like everything he does just comes across so effortlessly. It's just such a mark of his artistry and his lyricism. It's just like, whether he's bragging or whether he's like in his feels or everything in between, it just comes across so just like almost nonchalant. Just like he just kind of just is laying down on a couch with a mic and he's just kind of going at it. And it's like really impressive it's just like such a nod to his ability, man. Like,
right.
Yeah.
Dude. No, that's such a good point. I think that's some of the problems that I had with some of the tracks that felt like incomplete or like, there wasn't a ton of thought put into it, could just be like how amazing he is.
Right.
how effortless he can make something that's actually really hard to do. Mm-hmm. Same.
No, dude,
it's impressive.
Impressive. Yeah, it's impressive. And I piggyback around a little bit from the nonchalant part that you said, Alec and Todd. What do you guys think about the Sampha album? Alec, I know you sent it through. You say nonchalant. That's what I kind of think about Sampha as an artist in general. He's very like chilled and very laid back, and his music comes off like that. What do you guys think about the album?
Dude, I fucking love this album. I'm like such a big fan of it. I don't know. I think like I've been listening to a bunch over the last like since it came out. It just sounds so expansive to me. Mm-hmm. It's like a very, like the one word that really comes to mind is transcendent. It's just like when I'm listening to it, it's just like you can tell how much care and attention he has to every single sound, every lyric in all these songs. And kind of conversely to the Drake album, this one is one where it's like clearly an album. It's not just a collection of songs. There's a cohesive thread with it all. There's like elements of nostalgia and being introspective, and it's really cool, man. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Definitely takes me to a different place when I'm listening to it, which is the mark to me of a really good album. Kind of gives me,
I agree.
And it kind of like most of the lyrics, at least that I've digested, it's like speaks to humanity as a whole, even though it's his personal experiences, the way he kind of phrases certain things are really thought provoking. Like I was really impressed lyrically with what he did. I mean, from like some favorite tracks, like Suspended was such a standout. Jonathan L. Seagal, really like What If You Hypnotize Me and Evidence as well. And those are the ones that just like kind of blew me away. Even on the first listen, and I like still going back to it and discovering little parts and nuances with the instrumentation.
Dude, don't you love that when you listen to something and like when you listen to something so many times, but you still catching like little bits and pieces of things that like you're like, oh fuck, I didn't hear this the first listen. It's like such a good feeling.
There's like little bits of ear candy that just kind of continually present themselves, and I think that's like such a magical thing about music, and especially like this album.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I think this is like an incredible body of work by Sampha. I'm like really, really, really impressed. And just like you guys were talking about, the more I listen to it, the more I just like find little things that I love about it. But to be honest, when I first heard it, I think I listened to it at like the wrong time of day. Like I feel like this album really complements different aspects of the day for me. Like I listened to it like mid-afternoon. I was like hustling and bustling around town. I like threw it on in my car, and it was just like a little bit too reflective and almost like spiritual and like precious. It just had that sound of like, man, I need to like like, it wasn't doing it for me in that moment. And I kind of wrote it off as like, oh, this might not be for me. I like some of the stuff that I'm hearing. But then when it like really clicked in for me was the other day when I took an early morning run and it was like really foggy in Oakland. I just like woke up early on like 8 a.m. I was like, let me just throw on this album again because I knew we had this pod coming up and I wanted to be able to talk about it. Mm-hmm. And I was like this, and I was just like running through the fog, listening to the Sampha album. And I was like, oh my God, this album is so good. Mm-hmm. And it's so perfect for this moment. And it just like had me like thinking about my life in like a really reflective way. And yeah, so I think for me, it's just an album that's can like take me deeper in like this like warm, fuzzy, mm-hmm. like tasty feel when like during precious hours, like the like early morning or mm-hmm. like evening before I go to bed, you know, just kind of like wind down with it. Mm-hmm. And then it's just like super tasty on top of that. Like I love the beats. I love what he's doing on the track. So definitely certified fresh in my eyes.
That's sick, dude.
I love that, man. Yeah. Yeah, I think like that's such amazing. Good way to put it is from like the precious hours standpoint. Because like mm-hmm. the first time I listened to it was after a run, cooling down, just going for a walk like afterwards. And I threw it on and it was just like the perfect like euphoric kind of experience, like walking through the woods, mm-hmm. listening to that. And it was like perfect timing. But I can see how, mm-hmm. you know, you're just like, you, like 1 o'clock in the afternoon, like you're kind of buzzing, mm-hmm. things are going on, trying to listen to that digested is just not the time or place for it. Yeah. This one definitely needs attention and needs that like unwinding moment mm-hmm. to fully appreciate when you're listening mm-hmm. to it.
Yeah. It's a good thing to remember when you're listening to music, or at least like personally for me, you know,
nah, dude,
time of day matters, what you're doing matters.
100%. Yeah, I definitely learned that like I don't digest music well when I'm in the morning on my way to work. Like my mentality is not there to listen to the new stuff. It's just I'm not there with it. So I kind of like stopped doing that, and I realized that with Sampha's album. Like when I first heard it, I was like on my way to work and I was just like, this is too mellow for me. I always appreciated Sampha's sound, like his voice and his way of writing, the instrumentals that he picked. He usually picks are very interesting to me and super fucking cool and creative. But at first I had a hard time with this one. I was like, this is cool. I like it. And then one night I went out to get drinks with Audra and she was going home and I went home. And on a train on my way home, I was kind of buzzed a little bit and I put it back on. And I was like, oh, fuck, this is sick. I don't know, I guess I needed to like let loose a little bit and not just be so like uptight in the morning and thinking about everything that I have to do for the day. Being a little buzz kind of helped me let loose a little bit for the album and let the album just sit however it's going to sit with me. And that was like the perfect time for me. I was on a train, kind of buzz. I mean, you guys know that feeling. You kind of buzz in a train and on your way back home and you're like, fuck, yeah. This is sick, dude. This is fucking dope, like
you're just relaxed, like you're just like, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. Did you guys have any standout tracks on that, on the album, that like kind of hit you maybe a little bit more than others on like a first or second listen?
I think my favorite track was The Spirit 2.0,
dude. Yes. I was just about to say that.
Yeah. Reflections, moonlight hits your skin. Conversation, you question where I've been. Two bodies on this mattress. Suspended is good as well.
I don't know, it's just overall like it's such a cool sound to me. I don't know.
Yeah.
This is my first time, to be honest with you, hearing a whole body of work from Sampha. This is my first time ever. Like I heard like singles here and there, or like that feature he had with Drake a couple years back, but I never really heard much from him. And this is like my first time listening to a body of work. Yeah.
His voice is incredible.
Oh dude.
It's next level. It's right. Honestly, probably like my favorite vocalist right now. It's so unique and just so pure.
Yeah.
There's a lot of range that he can get to. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Get him on the pod when this thing blows up.
Let me contact his peoples.
Yeah. I mean, if he's not available, we can see if Drake is, you know. So,
dude, yeah. I mean,
yeah, we'll get just Drake in on case. Later. It's
fine. Yeah, it's just, yeah. He's like Lazarus.
We'll get Jay too while we're at it.
We'll give him something else to rap about being last resort on the graffiti pod.
Yeah, last resort, dude.
Hey, Drake, rap about carrots. Let's get this going. But no, one more thing before it kind of like evades me is like the, because I think it was five years between his last album and this album.
And oh, really?
Usually it's like pressure to get albums. Yeah. Yeah. Because like his last one, Process, was in 2017 or so.
And oh, shit, dude.
5 years, man, for albums. That's
crazy.
I don't know. It kind of reifies the fact that like time is your friend a lot of the time when we're writing albums and just songs. But especially for us, I feel like we can get so caught up in just like, okay, album's out, let's get the next one cooking, released by X date so we can do this. And like, it's important for us because we're obviously not at Sampha's level, but I don't know, just like time definitely helps. And I think he probably needed all that time for all this to just kind of sit and like marinate, and so he could really flesh it out to the album it is today.
What is did he do to stay relevant in between those 5 years? Do you know?
Good question.
He was on a lot of features. I think he did. He was on like, I think he was working with Kendrick quite a bit, and he was definitely like in features and pockets here and there. I don't know if he was like helping write as well, but yeah.
I'm sure, probably. Yeah.
He was like subtly staying relevant.
Yeah. Because he got his main break from that Drake feature, right? That's where he got like his main break from.
I think that's kind of where he kicked off, but I think he Subtract maybe was when he first like got on the scene or like really starting to look at him.
I forgot about Subtract. Dude. Yeah.
But yeah, that's a great point, man, of like, you know, 5 years taking your time. Uh-huh. Like you can really tell on this album that he took his time. Like all the little like intricate drum patterns and just like the details, man, like it makes a difference. So it's cool. I mean, like after 5 years, that's the album that you would expect.
Like, and you would hope for it too. If it didn't, if it didn't get to that level, you'd be like, fuck me.
Yeah. You can't take 5 years and not do that.
Dude, I feel like it's so hard though. Like as an artist to kind of like, realize that you need that, you know, that you need that time, because I'm pretty sure, like, for like you said, Alec, like I'm pretty sure the industry like pushes him to like, oh, we need something else, we need something now, we need, how do you like dumb down and be like, no, this is what I need, this is what I want, this was perfect for me.
I think that goes kind of in the movement of like us owning our own careers now. It's like we yes, labels are nice, but a lot of artists are choosing to like keep their masters and, you know, kind of like own their business more than just kind of outsource it and just kind of give away a bunch of it to a label. And they have that creative freedom to do what they want to do and like pace their music how they want to pace it and do everything else. Yeah. So it's
right.
Yeah. Yeah. To your point.
That's such sick. And I feel like we kind of doing that ourselves a little bit, you know, with our stuff. I feel like we don't rush into like jumping into back to anything or like push ourselves to like the next single, the next song, the next this, the next that, the next this. It's just like, yo, let's just flow naturally with it.
Yeah. I mean, we have the back catalog if we wanted to do that. Like,
right.
We have so many songs that we can just like start releasing if our goal was to just release songs, you know, but we're like even especially like this album cycle, we've got like 30 ideas. We're trying to narrow it down to 10, like release one good body of work and like over 3 okay bodies of work.
Right. Like what was, I don't remember, but what was the time frame between Getaway Trips and Radio? Like how long in the gap was that? Like a year, right?
Yeah, probably about a year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, about a year. A little bit.
Actually,
over
I went back and looked at the Kerhonkson trip where we started writing that just to see like what the date was. And that was September 2019. So that's like
Radio.
Wow.
Yeah. So that song was first, like the initial ideas in the Kerhonkson cabin. Like I remember you guys left to like get some food or something, or like get some snacks for the cabin. I stayed back, and then you guys like came back and we started writing Radio like right away.
That's crazy.
Like that was like 4 years before it came out. And obviously like we flushed it out for like a year after that before we shelved it and then like revived it, but dang, 4 years, man. I thought it was like 2 years.
Same, dude. That's crazy.
Do you know if that was our first Getaway Trip or was that like our second in the Kerhonkson spot?
I want to say it was the second because Well, actually, I don't know for sure. I remember writing some of those lyrics in Kirkconson, but I looked back at like the Airbnb receipts, and it looks like we took a trip in July 2019, and then we took a trip in September 2019. So okay. It could have been either one of those.
It could have been, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but like we took our time with that one. Speaking of taking time.
Right. We definitely
did. Almost didn't even come out.
Right. So for you guys, new listeners that don't know, we just released a song called Radio. Very, very fun track. Super dope vibes. It has like kind of like end of summer vibes in a way, you know, cruising on a highway. I've gotten that feedback a lot. Like, oh, this song feels like I'm like cruising in a highway and just like, you know, like kind of like, you know, moody colors a little bit and, you know, just vibing and you just feel good. The moment just feels good. So it's cool that we were able to translate that through that song after so many years and still like get our point across.
Damn, so happy with where we arrived with it.
Mm-hmm. Dude, big time. What was like you guys' favorite moments of that? I know you just said like we got back from the store and like immediately started writing Radio. Like what was your favorite moment of that?
I mean, I think for me at least it was, I do remember that. I remember writing it. And then at the end of it, I know we were all like almost on like cloud nine, kind of like we discovered something that sounds like us, that's maybe elevated to a different style than what we were doing at that time. Mm-hmm. And I remember the feeling of like discovering that after we first put those ideas down. And then honestly, listening to the first mix from Pat recently, right? Like, 4 months ago, where he really like took that mix where it was at to just a whole nother planet of existence. And it was just like, holy shit, this sounds better than I thought it would sound. So I think those two moments were just like bookends, but to me, those were the ones that stuck out to me.
Yeah, that was a pretty mind blowing moment to like hear where the mix went when Pat finally delivered it. It's like, damn. Yeah, shout out to Pat. But yeah, that first initial writing session when you guys got back was like so fun. I just remember, I think Alec, you wrote that guitar part and like lyrics just started coming from Quez. The hook just came pretty easily. And like, you know, it took a while for us to flush that song out, obviously 4 years, but like initially just to get those, like just like being out in the middle of the woods, you guys writing that, kind of just like going off in like a little bit of a new direction, a departure from other stuff we've been working on, was just really, really fun. So I remember that. And then the other like really good memory I have from that is drafting up the radio treatment. I remember I was sitting on my deck, kind of like draft, or for the music video, drafting up the treatment. And I like had this idea of Quez in the Cupid outfit at the end, in the video that isn't released yet. We're going to release it soon. But I was just like cracking up to myself, just like picturing Quez in the Cupid outfit. And then also just like picturing your reaction to that.
Dude.
I was like having a little like LOL moment to myself.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, it was definitely like a collab after that, just like initial idea. But then like, like texting with you about it and being like, did you read the treatment?
Dude.
You're like, yeah. Like, did you see the end? And you're like, like, I'm crying. I was just looking at the text again. You're like, I'm crying. Down to change it too. And then we all kind of let it go. And then eventually you're like, no, I'm down. I'm going to do it.
Dude, at first I thought it was a prank. I was like, this is definitely a prank. There's no way. There's no way he's real about this. By the way, great job at that, at writing that, you know, this whole script for that video. Like, great, great job. Like, that was so good, dude. It was amazing. Even looking back at the video now, it's like such a good video. Like, very well put together, dude. Great job.
Yeah.
Definitely a team effort, you know, like, man, just like so many pieces came together for that. The video looks amazing. Mm-hmm. Can't wait to get it out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Dude, it's close.
It's coming soon. Mm-hmm. Coming soon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Dude, yeah, my favorite moment of Radio. Yeah, when we got back from the store and like we started writing that, I remember us like just going back and forth with lyrics. Like I will hop on a mic and spit some, and then you hop on a mic tight. I remember even Alec even hopping on a mic for this, for something. Like I forget what you was doing on the mic or what you was saying, but you was definitely on there saying something. And so like just us feeding off each other's energy with that and being so excited about this new sound at the time that we had created for ourselves. It was just like such a good
moment. Remember we had some group vocals going. Like we were all kind of like hovered around the mic doing some maybe some of those oohs or something, just capturing that moment. Right. You know?
Yeah.
Even listening back.
I miss those trips, man.
Dude, we gotta make some happen. Yeah, we gotta go to Kerhonson again. Same Airbnb down. And everything.
Same creepy clown tent.
Oh, dude.
Man, you have some stories from that Airbnb.
Oh, that's my God. Sure.
Yeah.
What a.
Still, it's still upright. It's not burnt down. So that's a win.
Yes, yes. We almost burnt that Airbnb down.
Oh, my God.
We'll have to tell that story eventually.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I remember just being like, I'm gonna be so poor paying this shit back.
Short of it is that basically we thought that a like little drainage system in the backyard that was like kind of dipped down where the water was draining into it with these rocks was a fire pit. So we made a fire. And then, you know, fire was off to a great start. We're drinking beers around it, having a good time. All of a sudden we look down and there's a hole in the middle of the fire pit and there's like liquid plastic dripping in the hole with the coals and the burning like wood and the rocks and everything. Oh my God. I thought we were about to blow up the, I thought we were like,
which was a gas line, right?
Usually like, yeah. Like, which are usually metal, but I was like, oh my God, what if this is like the propane line or something? Like we're about to set off a bomb.
Have to blow this place up.
And so like the next 30 minutes we're just running back into the house, getting buckets of water, coming out like just in full firefighter mode.
Dude.
Luckily it was a sewer line, you know, so nothing explosive, but then we had to pay for some damages, but the house is still standing. And we're not in jail, so that's good.
Right.
Yeah.
Dude.
Still
I remember that. I remember having moments of like going back in the house and be like, yo, this house is going to blow up with me in it, dude. Like, like I was like back in the house, like getting water and shit. And I was like, oh, fuck, this is going to be it. Like, this is going to blow up and I'm going to be in it.
That's gonna be it. Tyler and I are outside putting water on it. And then all of a sudden,
dude, what the fuck?
Oh man!
And then you just walk out. Your clothes are a mess. Your hair is crazy.
Right.
It's like
hair is all gone.
You ever get the budget for this? Yeah. You ever get the budget? We should make a music video like that.
Oh, dude, 100%. Just blow Quez up.
Every Label's video treatment like, is like, what can we do for Quez for this video? Yeah.
Dude, yeah, Quez, this way he's just gonna run the house and it's just gonna blow up.
This makes no sense for the theme of the song, yeah, but it's cool.
It's gonna look good, trust me.
Just trust us. And you're gonna come back reincarnated as a horse, all right?
Dude. Sick, dude. Yo, that was hilarious. Yo, AJ.
Like Bojack Horseman.
Bojack. Yeah, so you guys were at a show lately, separately. It sounded pretty dope. Like, what was that about?
Yeah, man. So I went to a show recently. I went to see Selection out here in Oakland, which is a really awesome label that I've been following for years now. Joe K started it back in the day. I've kind of fallen off my radar a little bit, but I saw that he was coming through Oakland last weekend, so I went and checked it out.
Nice.
And man, it was just like I forgot how much going to shows like that like feed my soul. You know, like I had my Shazam out the whole time. Like, and more than just like going to the show. Like the show was super fun. It was like really kind of like house based in terms of genre. So it was like really dancey and I went with some homies and we had a great time. But I had my Shazam out the whole time, and like since that show, I've just been like going down this rabbit hole of all these different artists that I discovered. And so I was like, wow, I need to do more of this.
That's fire, dude.
Before for not just the show, but like all the residual artist discovery that comes after seeing like a show that's curated by a really, really amazing DJ. And I would say that like my favorite artist that I've discovered from it is this guy named Wilfie D. I don't even know where he's from, but he makes like the dopest house beats. Like for anyone listening to this that like likes house music, go check out Wilfie D.
Dude, that's sick, dude. That's Wilfie D. Wilfie D. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll definitely take a listen.
So would you say like this show kind of like was just kind of like a, like almost, it's like another catalyst for you to just go to more shows and just like discover more music too? Like did it kind of also hit the discovery mode where you're like, I need to find more artists and I need to listen to more music?
Yeah.
And like do that active like discovery.
Mm-hmm. I was like, I need to, yeah, not just discover music from my Discover Weekly. My Discover Weekly needs to be like seeing shows weekly.
Yeah. That's a cool ass, man. That's a sick ass fucking life, dude.
I love that. That is a sick ass life.
Let's go to shows weekly and shit.
I was thinking the same thing about Joe K. I was like, man, Joe K's got a sick ass life too.
Dude, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I felt the same way, dude. Yeah, I went to a show with a band called Tesseract, which is a kind of like a metal band that I've been listening to for probably like 6 or 7 years now. It was just like, kind of like to Tyler. It was like, man, I need to see more live music.
Dude, that's fun.
Such a good show. And like probably the most impressive vocalist I've ever seen live. Like he had such range on his like clean vocals and singing. Mm-hmm. But then his screams also were just like next level. But to see that live, because you usually just see one or the other, but you don't see them together. And you don't see him switching off at the clip that he was. And it was just like, how is he, like, is he human? And with the band backing him, it was so tight. I mean, they've been a band for a minute, and they're from the UK. But it was, I walked away feeling inspired and also depressed. I was like, man, I want to play more shows. I want to go to more shows. Like, it just, like, hit me so hard after that show for whatever reason. But in a good way, too, because I was also, like, super inspired to, like, for what we're doing and also just for going to more shows. So it was, like, it was definitely an experience that, like, stuck with me for the next 24 hours in a really interesting way. So,
dude, that's
go to more live shows. I think that's the message.
Yeah. Dude, I mean, that sounds really inspiring, man. Like even feeling like a little like envious or depressed or whatever afterwards, like that can like light a fire, you know?
Yeah.
100%.
Totally. Totally.
Dude.
Yeah. I definitely feel like it did that. So, yeah.
Talk about feeling depressed and stuff like that, and moments like that where you know you want to like, you like, damn, I should fucking be doing that right now. How do you guys stay creative and motivate yourself to like, you know, really, really go for it? You know, what kind of things you guys do with as a life hack to stay creative and motivated?
Yeah, at least for me, it's just been kind of like a combination of like putting in the work for it. I think like, I really small scale example, but I went to LA to get my recent tattoo, and I was really impressed with just his style of art. And I was like, outside of music, it'd be cool to have that outlet as well. So I picked up like an Apple pen and I got like Procreate on iPad, and I've just been like doodling and like drawing and shit like that. And it's been like a really nice,
dude, that's sick.
It's been like kind of meditative too, in a different way. And it's been nice to just have that outlet also. So just, I don't know, like just kind of not being afraid to venture into unknown territories like that and just kind of take a chance and just be okay with the fact that you're going to suck for a little bit, but it's going to be fun and you're going to get better. And also I've been kind of a fan of getting like coffee books recently about stuff, like whether it's like the Rick Rubin book about the creative process, which is just like a permanent fixture on our coffee table, or I have this like, nice. This like world history of tattoos for ideas and stuff like that. Cause it's just cool. Like where that art form came from. So it's just like things always around where I could just kind of open up a book and just kind of like maybe get some sort of inspiration, but if not, no worries. I'm still, it's just around, I think like setting up an environment that is conducive to that.
Dude,
in a way.
Fire.
So
nice. That's really dope. Congrats,
it's like
on that,
easy to see your motivations like lying around, or like easy to pick up something.
Just like when people say like, oh, I could never play guitar, but I have a guitar. Just like, I'm like, but where is it? And they're like, oh, it's in the basement. It's like, why don't you just put it in the living room? And then it's always there. And then 5 minutes, 10 minutes, you just pick it up and doodle around and put it back down. It's like super low key. It's easy. You don't have to commit to it. It's the same thing with all that other, stuff, you know, or it can be at least.
Yeah, I know. I mean, yeah, so much easier than like having the Rick Rubin book on a bookshelf tucked away in the back where it feels like, oh, this big deal or a big commitment if I'm going to pick this off the shelf. Like, nah, now I'm reading this book. Like, this is the book that I'm reading now. It's like, no, you can just like flip through it, like have it laying around. If it's a book that inspires you.
Totally.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that's really good. That's really dope, dude. Thank you for sharing that. That's fucking sick, dude.
Of course.
Yeah, for me, I mean, kind of it, like it changes, you know, I'm always like trying to figure out how to stay motivated. A lot of times that's like exercise, seeing shows like we were just talking about, different podcasts. Like lately I've been listening to this podcast by this guy named Ed Milet. He's like a motivational speaker. And for some reason, like his I want to say like teachings, rants, whatever you want to call them. Like they just, they speak to me and they're like, I don't know. Like some people could consider it like kind of cheesy because it's like motivational speaking. But if I throw one of those on, like I feel pretty fired up afterwards, you know? So yeah, that's, it's like whatever works for you, man.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's also got to be a little bit active too, right? Like you can't just like sit around hoping that you get some inspiration or some hoping that like it just kind of strikes you. And like maybe it happens and like it definitely happens on occasion, but like you still have to seek a place where that maybe can develop more.
Yeah.
You know, it's like figuring out a way where you can channel a different frequency or a different kind of energy that's
Leads
to that.
Yeah. It's like, action inspires motivation usually. Whereas like you usually, think that motivation inspires action. Yeah. It's like,
that's a great
point. Sometimes you don't want to do the action. You're like, I am like, why would I do this right now? Like, I don't feel good.
Yeah.
But
actually, that's why it's cool motivation. Too, man. Yeah. Because it's kind of empowering too. Cause it's kind of up to you. And it's not just on the whim of like whatever happenstance you're involved in, you know, it's like, it can be a little bit more of a pursuit.
How about you, Quez?
Me, it was like biking, you know, when I'm bike, I feel like I get so much energy back into myself, clears my mind. So it allows me to kind of like, you know, be more comfortable to do things and feel better about doing things. Also, like, you know, doing these like get ready with me on Instagram, like just getting dressed and like I feel like inspires like another thing in me.
I love those.
I have thank you.
Same.
I have so much fun doing those. And like something so little, like getting dressed, inspires me to go move on to something else. You know, we all get dressed every day. we have to, you know. So like, it's pretty cool that I found like something like that. Something so simple that we do on a normal basis to like inspire me to like write or, you know, move on to something else and like and feel comfortable with that. As well as like, you know, reading. I've been reading this manifestation book lately. And I kind of the same approach with like Alec doing in Utah, like, you know, just picking it up little by little, not forcing myself to like read through this whole thing in a week. Just picking it up as it goes, as I see it. It's like, oh, let me read this for like 5 minutes and see what's up to him and see if it has any message for me. And sometimes, you know, I find something that I really gravitate to and I'm like, oh, shit, like, all right, cool. Like, and sometimes I don't. Sometimes I'm like, hey, whatever. It is what it is. I got through it a little further. And putting no pressure on myself to do anything. There's times where you don't feel like doing shit and that's okay. Your body and your mind needs that, you know. And realizing that is like sometimes you spark inspiration in that as well. You know, what you said, action inspires motivation, dude. That's really dope.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's not mine. It's just something I've heard, you know,
dude, that's like, sick,
but I think about it. Yeah.
From now on, it's yours.
Right. That's it.
It's ours. Yeah.
But
we can just say, Graffiti came up with it.
Yeah.
I think that's the next album.
Yeah. But I think that's a good note to end on, guys. I, you know, gotta hop, unfortunately, but it's been great. Great chatting.
Good chat, dude. Good pod.
Yeah. Always good hanging with you guys. Thanks for hosting, Quez.
Thank you, man. Thank you for having me. The third podcast, dude. I'm proud of us.
Hey.
Yeah.
Third one.
Proud good of us, shit, boys.
Yes, yes. I'll
see you guys soon.
Enjoy the rest of your day, man. Both of y'all.
All right, you too.
Later, bros.
Bye.
Bye.
Hello, friend. Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed this episode. We want to take this time to thank you, specifically you, for taking time out of your busy schedule to listen. While we have you here, I hope you can follow us on all social media and streaming sites at Graffiti Royale. We also want to thank Jeremy Scott for mixing this episode. I'm going to leave you with a nice vibey tune by Graffiti Royale called Let It Go. All right, friend, until next time.